Welcome to the Alain Guillot podcast, a podcast about life, leadership, and money matters. Our guest today is Professor Oded Galor. Professor Galor is a professor of economics at Brown University and the founding thinker behind unified growth theory, which seeks to uncover the fundamental causes of prosperity and inequality over the entire span of human history. He's the author of 4 books, and today we will speak about his latest book, The Journey of Humanity, The Origins of Wealth and Inequality. Professor Galor, this is a huge segment that you have encountered here, the origins of wealth and inequality. I'm so eager to find out what is it that makes us so different. But before we get there, I wonder if you could tell us a little bit about your background. What is it that inspired you to become an economist, for example, and then what led you to work at Brown University?
So let me start with a few background information about myself as a researcher. At the moment, I would define myself as an interdisciplinary researcher. I'm a specialist in the field of economic growth, in the field of macro history, demography, cultural evolution, and the mathematical field of discrete dynamical systems. Now, over the past 3 decades, I was fortunate enough to be engaged in this fascinating research agenda that attempts to uncover the roots of wealth and inequality and derives the conclusion that much of this wealth and inequality is originating in the distant past. Now, what led me into this investigation? So I was born and raised in Jerusalem, and given the historical heritage of the place, I was gravitated gradually towards a better understanding of how initial conditions, how history affects human behavior, affects economic prosperity, affects diversity, and affects conflicts. And over my career, I developed this affinity further. I became a specialist in the field of economic growth, but at the same time, I was intrigued by the mathematical field of discrete dynamical systems, in which I was basically attempting to understand how initial conditions, namely history, can determine the fate of different societies, different economies, etc., over time. So this is the background that led me ultimately into this enormous exploration about the journey of humanity and the roots of wealth and inequality, which is my recent book. To just mention about this recent book, that it is entirely accessible. It is written for the general public. It is published by one of the best commercial publishers, Penguin Random House. And at the outset, it was commissioned for translation in 30 different languages. And this reflects the fact that the book is indeed captivating, or some of the endorsers defined as page turner, and it is entirely accessible. It is accessible to advanced high school students, to college students, to doctoral students, and at the same time, it is enriching and enlightening to top researchers in the field.
So I see from your book that the first, our entire lifespan of a couple of 100,000 years, we didn't advance much technologically and intellectually, or our advances were almost zero, and only in the past 200-300 years our advances have just catapulted. So can you take us back to the first chapter? You talk about how we develop our brain and it was different from all the other animal species. And what was that point that make us just accelerate our economic and intellectual growth?
Indeed. So as you suggested, the Journey of Humanity, the book, and this is in fact the English copy, is Exploring the evolution of human societies since the emergence of modern human in Africa nearly 300,000 years ago. And it concludes that over most of human existence, namely over 99.9% of human existence, since humans originated in Africa 300,000 years ago, and nearly till the eve of industrialization, economies were in a state of stagnation. And then at a certain point, there was this dramatic transformation, a dramatic takeoff that took the world from the earlier phase into the phase in which we live today. Now, as you said, a precondition for this evolutionary process was the evolution of the human brain that preceded, to a large extent, the evolution of Homo sapiens. So we see a gradual evolution of the human brain that naturally allows humans to be very different from other species. And they differ fundamentally by their ability to innovate. So humans are getting this capacity to innovate, and innovation that is taking place throughout human history is nevertheless not contributing to the prosperity of the population. And that's an intriguing finding in the sense that over most of human existence, technological progress is converted into more people rather than into richer people. And why is it so? Think about a farmer, say 5,000 years ago. When this farmer innovated and perhaps improved the plow or improved the seeds that were used in production, then the output was larger than otherwise. And temporarily, his family lived much better. But nevertheless, this family ultimately was able to sustain more children than before. More of the children survive, additional children were born, and consequently output per person or the yield per person declined back to the previous equilibrium position. So what we see over most of human existence is that technology is evolving gradually and is in fact accelerating over time, but nevertheless it is converted into more and more people, not into richer people. So in this 300,000 year of process, we move from stone tool of one type to a stone tool of another type into iron tool, etc. And ultimately in the eve of industrialization, we reach a stage in which the technology that we are employed is already steam engine technology. Now, nevertheless, despite this progress, much of it, or nearly all of it, is converted ultimately into more people rather than into richer people. And that's part of the reason that the world is in a state of stagnation. State of stagnation, not in the sense that there is no technological progress. We see this period in which there is stagnation in life expectancy. Life expectancy fluctuates in a very narrow range of 25 to 40. We see stagnation in income per capita and resources per person, but we do not see stagnation in terms of technology and in terms of the size of the human population. So if, for instance, you take the human population between the time of the transition to agriculture, 12,000 years ago, and the time of industrialization, the size of the human population increases 400-fold. And the reason is that technology is evolving and becomes faster and faster and more sophisticated, but the technology simply sustains more and more people, but not richer people.
So the major cause of inequality, I mean, there was no inequality before because we were all equally poor. And then inequality surfaced because the technological advances were not equally distributed among the population of the earth. So you have populations that are thriving while there are groups of people who are still today are hunter-gatherers, and they still have to live day by day according to how much they gather on that particular day. Is that right?
That's completely right. So what we see is that, as I said before, over most of human existence, societies are in a state of stagnation. And humans are not very different than other species. Humans are preoccupied by survival and reproduction. Living standards is very close to the subsistence level of consumption that can sustain a human being. And as you said before, there are very little differences in living conditions across time and across space. But then suddenly something very dramatic is occurring in the past 200 years. And we see this dramatic takeoff from stagnation to growth. But this is not an accident. It's in fact an outcome of a buildup that is occurring in the course of human history. Namely, technology is evolving more rapidly and more rapidly and more rapidly and more rapidly up till the point in which it reaches a critical threshold. And when it reaches a critical threshold, somehow we see a phase transition. Something very dramatic is happening. We see this dramatic takeoff in income per capita, and the world that existed up till 200 years ago is left behind. And just to understand it better, think about the metaphor of a phase transition in nature when water are converted into gas. Now, when we boil a tea kettle on our stove, then as we warm the temperature, as the temperature increases, initially very little is happening with the water. But then once we reach a critical level, the water are converted from liquid to gas. The same happened in the course of human history. In the course of human history, technology evolved more and more rapidly, initially very, very slowly, but then ultimately more and more rapidly. Once it reached a critical point, we see this phase transition, namely the equilibrium or the state of affairs that existed earlier evaporates, and we are gravitated into a new state, the modern state of economic growth. But as you said, it is not the case that all societies are taking off at once. Precisely as we see in the tea kettle. When you look at the tea kettle, some water molecules are converted into gas early, others are converting into gas much later. And as a result of it, there is a gap between those that converted into gas and those that remain in the tea kettle. The same is true in human history. Some societies are taking off early, others late, and a huge gap is occurring in the world economy.
But you suggest that the initial condition, and the initial condition, to my understanding, is how easy it is to have agriculture in a particular region does determine the wealth later on. So if that's the case, how come the people in Egypt are not the richest persons, people in the world with the Nile Delta and the facility that anything can grow in that area?
Absolutely. So there are a lot of initial conditions that matter. And that when I try to understand the roots of inequality, I peel gradually different layers of influence. I start with colonialism, I move into institutions, afterwards into culture, geography, and human diversity. Now, you're asking a very important question. If it's all about geography, which is not the case, then we would expect some societies in the Fertile Crescent, perhaps modern-day Iraq, modern-day Jordan, modern-day Syria, modern-day Israel and Egypt, to be the most prosperous nations in the world. And certainly for most of these countries, we do not see great prosperity. And why is it the case? So certainly the transition into agriculture that occurred first in the Fertile Crescent was very important for the development of new technologies. So those societies that moved into agriculture earlier brought about technological progress that persisted over time. So those societies had a surplus that permitted for the emergence of non-food producing class that was associated with knowledge creation in the form of science, in the form of languages, and in the form of technology. And this technology persisted over time. So indeed, if you look at the world, say, a few thousand years ago, we will see that the area of the Fertile Crescent, the area that is very close to the Fertile Crescent, is the most prosperous in the world. But ultimately, having comparative advantage in agriculture, having the capacity to produce agricultural goods more than others, is not very beneficial in the industrial stage of development. So the idea is that as we move into the modern world, as we move from the rural area into the urban area, most of the technological development occur in the urban area. And technological progress that occurs in the agricultural sector has very limited spillover. So what we see in the course of human history is that those societies initially flourish, but ultimately, as we reach, say, the year 1500, in fact, they suffer from a major liability, which is comparative advantage in agriculture. They specialize in the production of goods that have very limited spillover technologically, and ultimately, they lag behind and they remain behind. But there are a lot of other geographical factors that are very important in inducing cultural traits that are growth enhancing, or institutional features that are growth enhancing, etc.
In regards to culture, I mean, I see culture as one of the biggest determinants to wealth nowadays. For example, you take a culture as the people in Taiwan who just are workaholic, and that's probably their main focus of their day-to-day life. And then let's say the people from Afghanistan whose main focus is to follow the Islam and above everything else, above the contribution that woman can give to the society, above, I don't know, technological advances. And I think, for example, Afghanistan, they have the resources, if they wanted to have a better society, but they choose to follow the Quran instead. And so I don't know what my question is, or perhaps my question is, isn't a culture one of the biggest determinants as well of wealth?
Absolutely. So as I said before, when we think about the inequality as we see today, much of it was determined in the distant past. So institutional characteristics matter. For instance, if you think about the division of the Korean Peninsula, right, into sphere of influence of the communism in the north and sphere of influence of the west in the south, we see that this division generated an enormous gap between the north and the south. South Korea is 24 times richer than North Korea, and life expectancy in South Korea is 11 years longer than in North Korea. So institutions can matter. And as you just said, culture can matter a lot. If we hold cultural traits that are growth enhancing, then the growth process can be faster than otherwise. Or if we hold cultural traits that are basically based on gender biases, or based on short-sightedness in terms of investing in the future of the society, etc., then this can be detrimental. But what I'm arguing in the book, and that's why it is so important to read the details of the book to understand the structure, is that much of what we see in the context of culture and institutions is a byproduct of an earlier conditions. So for instance, one example that I give in the book is based on the work of Esther Bosserup, that in 1970 wrote about the importance of the plow in the emergence of gender bias in society. And what she argued is that if you look at societies and geographical places where the land was suitable for the use of the plow, in those type of societies, the plow was adopted. But since the plow require upper body strengths, it gave a comparative advantage for men in the production process. And consequently, over time, a gender bias emerged in society. Men allocated themselves to agricultural production, and women that before were cultivating the land returned to do housework. And this ultimately persisted over time. And when we look at these societies today, it appears that labor force participation of women is significantly lower than in other societies. So this is an example how geographical endowment is leading into cultural trait, gender bias that is very harmful for societies. Or you can think about another example. Suppose that you are residing in a geographical environment in which the type of crops that you have are very, very profitable to cultivate. So you engage in the process of agricultural cultivation, you plant and you harvest. But there is a delay between planting and harvesting. And this requires some sort of planning, some sort of future-oriented mindset. That's very important because the entire success of societies today is based on the ability to plan for the future, to educate our children, to save for the future, to invest in technologies, to preserve our climatic conditions, etc. And therefore, in those societies, where the agricultural endowment led naturally into greater long-term orientation, we see this cultural trait that is still prevalent today, and consequently societies are flourishing more than otherwise.
Okay, well, in your book, you have taken us back to 300,000 years into the past, all the way to the present. And this is an unfair question, but I wonder if, in the future, inequality will be reduced. And where do you see inequality 100 years from now?
Right. So, as you said, I mean, what the sort of the revolutionary conclusion of this book is that much of the inequality as we see it today is originated in the distant past. But the hopeful perspective that the book is generating is that, in fact, by learning about the past, by understanding our past, we will be in a better position to design and to affect our futures. So yes, if in fact policymakers will read the fundamental thesis and we implement these insights, namely design policies that are unique to each country, don't consider all countries in Latin America as one. Don't consider all less developed societies in the world as one. Understand that each country has specific history, specific geographic endowment, specific level of diversity. Once we realize this, we can design policies that could mitigate inequality. And in fact, we will see gradually inequality diminish in the world economy. So if you ask for my predictions in the context of the coming decades, then naturally we see the diffusion of technologies from the north to the south. And this is a source of reduction in inequality. We see that, in fact, medical technology in particular is being adopted by less developed societies. And that's very important because given the disease environment, these societies typically have less of an incentive to invest in human capital properly. We see other elements that are operating. I mean, so if you think about transportation technology, it basically permits the world to be closer than before. And in addition, the information technology revolution is permitting individuals to see cultural traits that appear elsewhere that are growth enhancing. All these processes permitting an adaptation of these elements, and this adaptation should narrow inequality over time. But again, the key here is to understand some of it will occur by itself because naturally individuals are rational and they will adopt what is good for them. But in addition, since they are very long and entrenched cultural and institutional characteristics in certain societies, in order to overcome the barriers in development, we need to design a policy that is country specific, that will permit societies to flourish more than otherwise.
But when we speak about designing policy, for example, the United States, they would decide policies that are beneficial to the United States, which is not necessarily beneficial to Chile or to, I don't know, Congo. So how will you get politicians or leaders to work together in order to reduce this kind of inequality globally?
Right. So I think that part of naivete on the part of policymakers was reflected in the past in what was known as the Washington Consensus, where basically the World Bank, the IMF, and other international institutions were advocating a set of reforms that they felt can basically allow less developed societies to grow very rapidly. But as I said, the inability of these policy reforms to make a meaningful impact had to do with the fact that one policy reform was advocated for all societies. And as I said before, if we think about different societies, we should target different elements. So yes, it's very important to educate the population, but it's very important at the same time to emphasize the particular curriculum elements that can make a difference. So let me give you an example. So one element that I'm emphasizing in the book, and the reader will be able to be exposed to, is the element of diversity. And I show that overly diverse societies tend to suffer from conflicts. Overly homogeneous societies do not benefit sufficiently from cross-fertilization of ideas and therefore suffer at the level of innovations. And that there is an intermediate level of diversity that is conducive for development. Now, so take an extreme society in one end of the spectrum and another extreme, a very diverse society, say in sub-Saharan Africa, that suffers at the moment from conflict. So the education that the World Bank should advance to this type of society is education that is geared towards tolerance, right? Geared towards social cohesiveness, and geared towards respect for others and respect for different ethnic groups. This will mitigate the cost of diversity and will allow the society to benefit from cross-fertilization of ideas that are associated with diversity. But take the other end of the spectrum. Suppose that there is a society in the world that is relatively homogeneous. For this homogeneous society, you would like the education curriculum to be very different. You would like there that, in fact, the society will emphasize thinking outside of the box, challenging the status quo. And as a result of it, generating pluralism that is so important for innovations and cross-fertilization of ideas. So again, unless you understand the precise history of each particular geographical location, you cannot design an effective policy that can mitigate inequality across the globe.
Right. Just one last question. So in great part of your book, you also talk about how our technological advances have allowed us to increase our population, and that has been the way that we have profited from our wealth. But now we have in many industrialized countries a negative or stable population growth. I wonder, where do you see our population growing, stabilizing, or decreasing?
My prediction is that, in fact, the population of the world will decline in the coming, naturally it's still growing, and there is the legacy of population growth from the past. So it will take some time till we will see this reversal. But my prediction, if you think about the next 50 years or the next 100 years, we see already that fertility is below replacement level in many countries, certainly in Western European countries, but most recently, even India, the second most populous country in the world, is just reached replacement level. So the general tendency is towards a reduction in fertility. And in this respect, the population of the world is expected to decline. To a large extent, this is very good news for planet Earth, because this will mitigate the pressure on the environment. Actually, we are polluting, and the more of us around, the greater is the amount of pollution. But in addition, it will allow families and households to invest more in the education of their kids. They will have fewer kids, but much more educated kids. And as a result of it, it's not inevitable that technological progress will slow down due to the decline in the size of the population, because the population will be much more educated and consequently will be able to maintain the pace of technological progress.
Wow, Professor Galor, there's a lot to digest in your book. As you said, everything is easy to understand, but there's we had to take pauses to digest the information that you are giving to us. I wonder if you could tell us one more time the title of the book and where can the listeners follow the work that you're doing?
Absolutely. So the title is The Journey of Humanity, The Origins of Wealth and Inequality. It appeared in Penguin Random House in the US, Penguin Random House in the UK, and it will appear in 30 different languages across the globe. It's supposed to be a very popular book. It is a popular science book, a macro history book that, as I said before, can enlighten top researchers in the field, but at the same time can enlighten a high school student that is interested in the history of the world and about the roots of inequality. So it's very general. It contains an enormous amount of fascinating evidence. And according to most people that endorse the book is what they defined as a page turner. It's captivating, and I'm certainly encouraging your readers to purchase the book and to read it. I think it will be a stimulating experience.
Well, all the links will be in the show notes. Professor Galor, thank you so much for your time.
Absolutely. My own pleasure. Take care.